Hello there, and welcome to this week's edition of the Business Roundup. My name is Baila Ksasia, and as always, we are diving in to figure out events that happened during the week concerning business. And also, we have an analyst on set with us, that's Paul Bushayozi, who is helping us get to understand these events and what they mean for the economy. Thank you so much for joining us for today's interview. Let's start off with the unfortunate death of Keith Muhakanzi, now the late, the former Secretary of the Treasury. What does this mean for the central bank? And it's like a second blow after the governor's death. What does this mean for the bank and for the business community as a whole?
Okay, first of all, obviously it's tragic. Unfortunately, Mr. Muhakanzi has been battling illness for quite a while. By the time he was transferred to the office of the Prime Minister a year or two ago, he was already, a bit under the weather. So, you know, it's unfortunate. I think he had, in theory, I think we can say in theory, he'd moved out of the management of the economy, as you know, which he did as Secretary of the Treasury at Ministry of Finance. So, I think it's more about what is his place in the history of Uganda as an economic manager, and especially over the last 37 years since 1986. I think him, the former governor of the Bank of Uganda, Emmanuel Tumsimu Mutebile, and Mr. Chris Kasami, who also at one time was the Secretary of the Treasury and the Permanent Secretary before Keith Muhakanzi, those three gentlemen, we owe them a lot of gratitude in this country for their management of the economy and their conviction about how we had to do the things. They were fallible, of course, they made mistakes, but I think the net effect of their involvement in the economy has been positive.
Okay, and so, of course, conversations do suggest that these two men, the latest to die, that's the governor and now Keith, these were people who are really influential, as you've pointed out, and they had, a certain bargaining power with the president to be able to say, you know, this is where we need to go. This is where we should now steer the country towards. So without such a driving force, what do you see happening, especially in making decisions for the central bank and other related entities that determine where this economy heads next?
I think, yeah, you're right. These three gentlemen were instrumental, especially they had the ear of the president. They were really grounded in their knowledge of economics, but even better still, they had real-time experience in the economy of Uganda. They knew the whole discussion around how to get Uganda out of the hole. They lived through recovery and eventually kind of maintaining stability after we kind of got over the worst period. Now, the biggest thing about these three gentlemen is their, of course, their conviction, their grounding in economics, and their ability to talk to the president and to debate the president on what needs to happen.
And it's indeed such a loss for the country. May his soul rest in eternal peace. Let's now switch gears to the Honorable Mary Goretti Tutu, who has been offered bail, granted bail. And so, I mean, we should not focus most on how she got bail or whatever else happened, but I just really wanted to ask you a question that I am passionate about. Do you think that getting one person and pinning her in this whole thing is going to sort out whatever else has happened before this in regards to corruption?
I think, first of all, we shouldn't underplay the effect of corruption on ourselves as a country. Corruption means that services are not delivered. And so our health services, although we are constrained for money, even the little money that we have is pilfered, or let's call it stolen. Education the same, and our infrastructure and many other things. But education, health and infrastructure are particularly important, because if you're going to get people out of poverty, those three things have to be in place. Your people have to be educated so they can take advantage of opportunities. They have to be healthy so they can be working more days than they are sick. And they need to have infrastructure to and from market. So if you've got a corrupt society, chances are those things are not happening. So people are not coming out of poverty as they should. Secondly, corruption concentrates resources in a few people. So if you stole a billion shillings in Uganda, I remember from a few years ago, that would be the amount of money spent on 41,000 inpatients in Mulago in a year, something like that. So if you take 1 billion for yourself, that means 41,000 people just, they can't get adequate healthcare.
Yeah.
So whereas it seems as if it's endemic in Uganda, corruption, and we kind of all have embraced it or whatever, it's a serious issue. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Paul, for that.
Piece
of wisdom. We appreciate it, and we hope to see you again next week.
You're welcome.
Okay, and thank you very much, dear viewers, for making time for this Business Roundup once again. Every week, catch us on Fridays here on the news. I am Bailaxas here. We wish you a good night.